Good afternoon or evening. Shannon Smith Crowley, representing American Association of University Women for California. Also have been asked by the Coalition to Abolish Slavery and Trafficking and the National Council of Jewish Women to also register their support of number 4. We would like to make one comment that we would like, as forced labor is actually much more prevalent than sex trafficking, we would like for the definition of human trafficking to include all forms of human trafficking.
Thank you.
Madam Chair and members, Joe Michael for Equality California, and I am in support of, we are in support of issue 3 and proposal number 4, victims of commercial sexual exploitation. And just to state very briefly, we're supportive of this, in strong support of this, particularly because lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender youth are disproportionately
we're only doing
to
Me
sex
Too.
So just wanted
you.
To note that, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Hi, Kathy Van Austin, representing the John Burton Foundation, in strong support of number 3. Also, as a board member of Sierra Forever Families here locally, I'm here to support number 5 as well. It's a program that has worked extremely well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sean Hughes of the Alliance for Children's Rights, here for Kinship Equity, number 3.
Thank you.
Susanna Niffin with Children Now, and we're in support of all of these measures, and just want to point out that even if you do each and every one, you're still spending less than $100 million on your own children, so please don't make us pick and choose.
Thank you.
Jackie Ruth Heiser with the California Alliance of Child and Family Services, and although we're the sponsor of the FFA social work rate increase, we deeply support all the proposals and really hope with Susanna it isn't a matter of having one that's more important than the other one. Thank you.
Again, Kyle Sporleader with the California Youth Connection. We represent the very unique voice of the youth in this state who the system is trying to serve. And so in representing that voice, we support all of the various proposals you heard today. We'd like to emphasize our support of item 3, the relative caregiver equity. But as Susanna and Jackie both said, these are all needed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Any comments from the committee? Did he leave? Where did he go? Okay. You want to do Me Too with all 5? Okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. My name is Kevin Asnia with the Coalition of California Welfare Rights Organizations. We support number 4 and number 3. And in supporting number 3, we want to point out that it would be good if kids could get $800 a month, including CalWORKs kids. And I want to point out that CalWORKs kids right now live on a fixed income of what they got in 1987. 500,000 CalWORKs kids live and below 29% of the poverty level, and that results in neglect. And as you can see, 84% of the kids in foster care are victims of neglect. So we need to raise the grants to stop the foster care.
Thank you.
All kids are the same. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Yes, Mr. Dickinson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I want to thank you, Madam Chair, for allowing us to have this panel this afternoon to hear these proposals, as well as thanking those who presented and those who've testified. We often talk about foster children as being our children, and yet we often treat them not only in a penurious fashion, but one that's penny wise and pound foolish, in my judgment. We're fortunate enough to be in a circumstance where we may have some money to invest, with all due respect to the Department of Finance. And as we consider where we might invest some money, I have a hard time thinking of a more appropriate place than in our children. These are all high-quality proposals from my point of view. They vary quite widely in their cost, but I think that should not necessarily be the determinative factor in what we might ultimately consider here, although I'm sure it will be some element of that. I just want to make a quick comment on a couple of them, and my comments are not meant to mean that I don't think the others I don't say anything about are not without great value as well. But one thing that seems clear to me is that we have to do a better job of compensating those that we expect are going to care for our children in foster care. And we can't expect that we're going to be able to recruit and retain people of high quality and commitment to a profession if they aren't compensated adequately. So to me, that's an area that needs attention in some form or fashion, whatever it might be, along the lines of the proposal here or some other approach. Secondly, we talk a lot about placing emphasis on the two most successful areas for foster children, and that's when reunification is not a viable option. And that's kinship placements, and permanence. Again, if we're going to be successful in as many kinship placements as possible, then we are going to have to treat relatives of children differently than we're treating them now compared to others taking care of our foster kids. They don't buy shoes and food and pay the rent for those kids on psychic income or on emotional attachment. Now, those are clearly important elements, but it's money that pays the bills. And I think it's unrealistic to expect that relatives are going to be able, in many instances, to take on the additional responsibilities and cost of taking in a child, relative or not, if it's unaffordable. So doing something in that category, I think, is also compelling. And finally, I think that permanence is the ultimate result that makes a difference in a child's life. And, you know, this was really punctuated for me some years ago when I talked to a man who was 55 years old, and he told me that he had just been adopted 2 months before that. And I thought that was quite curious. And I asked him why at the age of 55, he clearly was a mature adult himself, that it was so important to him that he'd been adopted. And he said, because now, for the first time, I have a real family. It doesn't matter what age you are, having a real family that you know will be there forever is the ultimate achievement. It's an accomplishment. It's something that so many of us take for granted, but I think it is clear how much it means to those who don't have what we all take for granted. I know from my own experience in Sacramento County, and I note a letter from my colleague, Supervisor Don Natoli from the Sacramento County Board of Supervisors, that the investment in permanence that's been described here in proposal number five works, and it pays for itself over time, which is the best of all. So to me, the investment in permanence makes sense programmatically, and we have a proposal that makes sense financially with some seed investment. So Madam Chair, I know we're going to consider these in the weeks ahead, but I hope those are some thoughts that might help guide us as we consider these proposals and others in this category of how we best take care of our foster kids.
Okay. Mr. Chancellor, did you have anything you want to say? Yeah. Okay. Okay, I want to thank... Okay, exactly. Yeah. I want to thank those who came today who made the proposal. I want to thank all of you who traveled such distances who came. And even though you didn't get a chance to talk a long time, because we still have another half of an agenda to go through with some more panels. But I want to thank you for coming and let you know that your comments were not just tossed to the wind, that they, you know, we are calculating and recording the comments, and we're taking all of the things that come in. And working on those issues, critical, I think, to this issue and several groups in the Capitol here is the issue of families, the issue of young people, the issue of what happens to our children, which becomes critical in the things that we do. You know, I always believe that every society is judged by what it does for its elderly and what it does for its children. That determines the character of any organization, any nation, any group of people. So clearly we have a lot of work to do in California with regards to our children, making sure that they all have families, that they're safe and that they're cared for and that they're wanted and needed. If not, we will continue to reap the whirlwind in terms of the things that happen when and they become adults without that anchor, without that value system, without that support. And that's really what we tend to do when we talk about welfare, you know, taking care of the, making sure that our folks have some sense of belonging and understanding and support that's there. So we'll continue to work on these issues. This is extremely important to us. I want to thank my colleagues for making sure the issue came forward, and those of you who had proposals as you looked at the budget that's there. We do have money, some money this year. It is important that we reinvest in California again. The governor has not necessarily put it in his budget, but it surely is a part of our thinking in the assembly, and I believe in the Senate as well. When you look at some of the ideas that are coming out, that we have to, that we've done some things over the years that weren't necessarily things people chose to do, but they had to do because they didn't have resources. And now that we've got a few more resources, it's an imperative that we basically assess where we are, not go back and do the same things over and over, but really assess what we've done and make sure that we try to clean up and do as much good as we possibly can in going forward. And caring for our children really is extremely important, making sure those children who are the most vulnerable in society have support and have the support of not of their families, but surely of the state of California, to have the kind of life and future that we think they should have, so they can then be good, productive citizens when they move forward and do likewise for others. So once again, thank you for coming. I appreciate your comments. Appreciate everyone who came. Clearly, you've raised some important issues and issues that will definitely be considered. So thank you so much.
So, Madam Chair, one other thing I would add is, even though we have many, many demands on us to try to figure out how to rebuild the important services of the state, the dollar amounts here also are fairly modest.
They are, compared to.
Yeah, I mean, I think people have not come forward with the real dollar need. They've come forward with, you know, a responsible attempt to say, what can we do to begin to rebuild critical services for our foster youth and their families. So.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you so much. This item, too, will be moved over, rolled over, as we look at various proposals that we have for reinvestment. This brings us to CalFresh, which is also another item of great concern. And this is item number 4. We'll be looking at CalFresh, and we have, I guess, Linda Patterson, who will be here, who will be addressing the issues that we've given her, as well as Adam Dontro, who will also is also here, and our LAO office. We've asked them to address some issues as well. Okay.
I'd say good afternoon, evening.
We never know in this room, huh?
In the interest of time, I will do a very brief overview and then basically respond to the question at hand. So as the CalFresh program is what we call the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program in California. Basically, the eligibility standards are set by Congress and the USDA. Benefits are 100% federally funded. We supervise the implementation of the program. It's administered at the county level. We have 4.3 million persons enrolled and issue about $7.6 billion a year. And our household composition is by who purchase and prepare together. Our income thresholds are 130% of the federal poverty level, except for households with elderly, disabled, and a few other exceptions. Net income is 100% of FBL. Benefits are loaded on an electronic benefit card, and there are certain restrictions what they could be used for. I have a chart that shows kind of those income thresholds, average monthly benefit around $151 per person per month. Employment program, employment and training program, disaster CalFresh, those are just some of our other programs. Our error rate is on trend. So I'll get to the question, unless anybody has questions over the brief overview, I'll get to your question about participation. Is that okay?
Sure.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, so I think we're doing real well in administering the program. The one where we're really playing a lot of catch up is in our participation. Data from the federal government from 2011, which is about 3 years old, shows that only about 57% of those eligible participate in the program. The national average is 79%. We would say that, you know, we are making great progress in this area, and I have a chart that kind kind of shows how our growth, especially since 2010, 2011, 2012, has started to outpace the national growth. And at this point, even the national growth has basically flatlined, and we are still increasing. And you could see that we are making good progress on the chart to kind of catch up with the national average. And part of that is due to some of the recent legislative initiatives that have been implemented. Specifically, I'd like to point out AB 6 from October 2011, eliminated fingerprinting requirements for CalFresh that was a barrier. We've also, in October of last year, implemented semi-annual reporting instead of quarterly, and that was a kind of an onerous, burdensome thing to clients that resulted in a lot of them going off for procedural reasons. So removing some of that barrier. Also done a lot of modernization that made it easier for people to access our system, particularly working poor. We also kind of partnered with people like Department of Education on bills like AB 402 to make sure that those enrolling in school lunch program also knew about CalFresh and vice versa. So kind of partnering in with some other entities to make sure we're getting the word out where possible. And one of the major things that we've done starting last year was to work with counties and set a three-year goal-setting process to help achieve increased California participation. And some of the specific things that they were working on are, like, we have people on Medi-Cal who are very likely eligible. They're in our system. So how do we reach into those of that population to see who needs our benefits? That's fairly easy. Trying to increase our outreach to seniors. Addressing the churning and retention of cases, which a lot of times we had people going off and then coming back on in, you know, 30, 60, 90 days over things like didn't turn in a report, didn't complete recertification. So trying to reduce that churn factor. So counties submitted all of their plans on how they propose to do that and some of the best practices, which we share with counties. We've made great progress in terms of our error rate, partly by that. The tactic of sharing the information, sharing the data, and then sharing what counties are doing well with other counties that are experiencing problems and kind of driving the performance by sharing the data. And kind of in that vein, one of our recent innovations, and I think it's the first in the nation, is putting out what we call a data dashboard. And that measures every county in terms of a number of different issues, not only their error rate, but their timeliness, their churn rate, you know, how many cases are being churned to the system. Also, what is their inreach to their Medi-Cal population that looks potentially eligible and vice versa. We also provide some demographic data so that a county can compare themselves to the state. They compare themselves to a similar county, like what percentage of elderly do I have in my county and how many of them are in my caseload? Where am I missing my target? And so that is something that we have implemented. It's up on our public website. Feel free to check it out. I've passed out a copy. But I think that sharing that kind of data and then the resulting best practices will help us achieve our goals of increasing participation in this important program. So we appreciate the support we've had through the legislature to reach those goals. And at that point, I'll turn it over for questions.
Okay, do we have any comments? Mr. Dondro?
Actually, Adam Dondro is going to come up for the next panel. I'm Todd Bland, also with the California Department of Social Services. Here, if you have any other questions about CalFresh or potentially about EFAP, but we'll bring Adam up in a moment.
Okay. Anyone from the LAL, any comments?
I don't have any specific comments, but we were asked to present a table, so if you're ready for that, we can go ahead and do that.
We can do that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Ryan Woolsey with the Legislative Analyst's Office. We were asked to briefly discuss how benefit levels in the CalFresh program are determined and how those have changed recently. So in general, the benefit levels in CalFresh are determined by federal law, and families that are larger receive higher benefits than families that are smaller. Families with higher income receive lower benefits than families with no or low income, up to a maximum amount. And the maximum amount under federal law is generally increased on an annual basis in October if there's been an increase in food prices. Mm-hmm. So generally, food benefits are going up every year. That being said, there are two events in the past year that I was specifically asked to highlight that have affected CalFresh benefit levels outside that annual update process. So you've received a handout that's entitled Recent Changes in CalFresh Benefit Levels. And this describes the CalFresh benefit levels that a family of three, a hypothetical family of three, could receive under two scenarios. One, if they have no earned income and receive CalWORKs assistance in addition to CalFresh. And the second scenario is if they have income from one full-time job at the minimum wage, so about $1,400 a month in income, and only receive CalFresh. In the table on the left column shows what that family would receive in October of 2013 as sort of a baseline point. The family that's on CalWORKs and CalFresh would have received a CalWORKs grant of $638, which is the maximum amount for a family in a high-cost county. They would additionally receive a CalFresh benefit of $523. Putting these together brings you to about 71% of the federal poverty line. But as an alternative frame of reference, under a higher threshold based on the Census Bureau supplemental poverty measure, these benefits together would come to about 55%. And just for your information, the SPM threshold is higher primarily because it takes into account cost of living in a way that the FPL does not. For the other scenario, if the family were to have earnings, you can see the benefit, the CalFresh benefit, is lower because the earnings are higher. And for that family, the total resources, earnings plus CalFresh, are 108% of FPL, but 83% of the SPM-based threshold. Now, the first of those two more extraordinary changes in CalFresh benefit levels that I referred to happened in November of 2013. This dates back to a decision that Congress made as part of the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act to boost the benefits in the CalFresh program as sort of an advance inflation adjustment, so increase the value of the benefits before the price of food went up. Congress subsequently made a decision to remove that boost before inflation had caught up, resulting in a nominal decrease in the amount of benefits the family received in the month of November. So for both the family that is on CalWORKs and the family that's not on CalWORKs, that resulted in a $29 reduction in their CalFresh benefits in the month of November. The second change that has recently affected CalFresh benefit levels only applies to CalFresh recipients that also receive CalWORKs assistance, which is a relatively small portion of the CalFresh caseload. In March of 2014, the CalWORKs grant was increased by 5%. This additional income resulted in a slight offset in reduced CalFresh benefits. In the case of this hypothetical family, about $9. So that's just a breakdown of some of the recent changes in CalFresh benefit levels.
Okay. Okay, any comments?
I didn't, maybe I missed it, but did you address the effect of the I'm trying to think of the right term here, the cross-eligibility efforts between the sign-ups for expanded Medi-Cal and CalFresh?
I didn't bring that up, but that's been a great opportunity for us, and we've really tried to make the most of it. I think Adam Dondra will talk more about our horizontal integration, but I know that we've made we've worked in partnership to put an indication on our application if they want health coverage, and so that they can be automatically enrolled via express lane eligibility in there, and vice versa.
That's what we're
working on, enhancing that. We do get a referral from them, but we are taking the opportunity for everybody that goes through that portal to ask, are you interested in CalFresh and a referral? And there's plans that Adam will talk about how to make that more automated so that the information transfers over.
Well, if I got ahead of you in your presentation,
yeah.
I apologize.
Okay.
I'll be patient.
That's fine. I was steaming through because I knew you guys had a long day, so that's
okay.
Fine.
Thank you.
Adam?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. It's first want to thank the committee for the support for my unit at Social Services. It's somewhat unique in being able to focus on something like integration, but as all of you well know, absolutely integral to coming up with a system that's effective for the clients and the people providing the services. So you've got a short presentation, though I will just say up front, I am more than happy to come speak with you and any of your offices about what we're doing on an ongoing basis. So horizontal integration, essentially, the short of it is focusing on the client holistically, not focusing on how do I provide my program services to my client, but how do I look at the client as an individual and what they need and treat all of those needs holistically. That's the key to what we're trying to focus on and do. And the purpose of that, on the second slide, the importance of that is that that's how you lift people out of poverty. That's how you provide for their health and enhance their employment opportunities. And that's how you get people to a place where they're able to have a sustaining lifestyle on their own. That's really the goal of it, is to treat that person as a whole individual meeting all of their needs. And I often liken that to Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You can't focus on step three and just making sure they have health care coverage if they don't have a place to sleep, if they don't have food to eat. You have to treat all of those things together, or else you're really just treating symptoms one by one. So that's what we're trying to focus on. On the third slide, we've put together a vision, mission, and values. And again, you'll see repeatedly throughout all of these pages, looking at the well-being of the individual, treating them holistically, focusing on that client-centric. And that's really what we're working on, is a culture change within our department, within our agency, within the whole community, getting people to look at those clients as individuals with a spread, with a spectrum of needs, instead of focusing on a particular program that they may be housed in. And it is a culture change. It's not easy, because each of these programs is important. The work that people are doing on ACA and providing health care is extremely important. And it's hard to say, but step back and look at, we also need to make sure these people are getting the food that they need to eat to stay healthy after they're treated. And so that's the process that we're working through. The next two slides kind of show the pre-integration, where we've typically been, which are independent silos, independent systems that don't communicate well, that don't talk to each other and share information. And on the following slide, where we're driving towards, which is an integrated system, client-centric, performance-driven, pieces of that around shared governance. You set that vision that everyone drives towards. You provide a governance structure, because inherently with integration, you lose some autonomy. When systems need to talk to each other, decisions about how those systems operate need to be made collaboratively. So setting up a governance structure to drive towards those things, and again, providing easy access for the individual. We don't say we need one door for people to come through, but no wrong door, so wherever they come to, they can get treated for all of the things that they need and not redirected from place to place to place to complete application after application after application. The benefits of integration, kind of went through those piece by piece there, so I'll just briefly say, we haven't been around long, but we're already seeing the benefits of what we're doing. We've been able to, and when I say we, I help facilitate. Linda and her CalFresh staff have just been heroes in this process. They put together, one of a kind in its nation, a multi-benefit application. So when somebody comes in and says, I need Medi-Cal, I need CalFresh, I need CalWORKs, or comes in and says, I don't know what I need, help me figure it out, we say, here's one document. You fill this out, and we'll work through the rest with you. So that's been a huge benefit to the clients that come in. As Linda mentioned, we've worked with the CalHERS folks at Covered California to make sure that there's a referral process. When people come in for health, we make sure to say, what about CalFresh? What about CalWORKs? Do you need these services? Let us know so that we can reconnect with them for those services. In addition, the Express Lane that has been hugely successful, led by Department of Healthcare Services, but we've been helping out because we're identifying those people in CalFresh already who also need that healthcare coverage. And then again, the next slide talks a little bit about where we're going to continue to go in identifying additional populations that we can work with. We want to keep enhancing that interface with the CalHERS Covered California portal to make sure we can get people while they're in front of us to complete that application so we don't have a lag time and lose some of those people in the process. And looking at emancipated youth foster care who are newly eligible for health care, different populations. So it's an ongoing process. We greatly appreciate your support. And of course, any questions, I'd be happy to answer.